Hello guys, I'm Yvette. Want to know what's new? Well, let's check out today's show. We meet a 13-year-old Kenyan who's taking the gospel music by storm and has big plans for this type of music.
I would like to take it globally, and you should expect more songs for sure.
From Storm Anna to Cyclone Batsirai, why are these devastating tropical storms getting stronger? And what do these squiggly worms have to do with climate change? We head to Kenya to find out.
Eventually, even children get to know how to handle the earthworms because they are completely harmless.
Hello and welcome to What's New from BBC Africa. Now, let's start the show with our first guest who's no ordinary teenager. 13-year-old Shana Manjeru is the youngest ever AFRIMA Award winner. The Old Africa Music Award star won the award in 2021 for her song God Will Make a Way in the category of Best Female Artist in African Inspirational Music. She beat well-known singers from several African countries, including Nigeria, Uganda, and South Africa. Our reporter Anita caught up with Shana in Nairobi to find out more about her success. God will make a way where it seems to be no way.
God will make a way where it seems to be no way. She is the youngest ever All Africa Music Award winner, popularly known as AFRIMA, at just 13 years old. Shana won the award in the category for the Best Female Artist in African Inspirational Music for her song, God Will Make a Way. Let's go meet her.
Hi, my name is Shana Manjeru. I am a gospel musician. I'm in class 7. I like dancing, singing, acting, among others. What music means to me, means a lot because it has given me a voice and a platform, which is really a great thing.
Welcome on stage a prodigy who at 13 years old is the youngest nominee in the history of
Being the youngest ever female award winning nominee, I feel amazing because people are noticing my talent, you know, and the gift that God has given me.
And the winner is Shana!
When I was nominated, I didn't really think that there was a chance for me to win because there were a lot of huge musicians out there, so I wasn't sure that me, as young as I am, would win, but I mean, yeah, I won.
How and when did you get into music?
I have always had a passion for singing, but then my parents noticed when I was 3 years old. It was a Sunday after church, and we had gone to eat lunch in a restaurant. So we took our orders and started eating, but then I just had an urge to sing. So I stood up on my chair. Apparently that was what I saw as my stage. And I started singing. And from there, my parents noticed that I had a passion for singing, and now they are supporting me.
That's right. Shana is making big waves in the African music scene and now has her sights set on even bigger things.
God will make a way where it seems to be no way.
Some of the challenges I've faced are, for example, if I haven't mastered some words in a song, or not getting enough platforms to share my music. Well, I balance school, being a TV host, and music. by setting times for each.
Open your eyes.
I would like to take it globally, and you should expect more songs for sure. And because I release gospel music, which is not such a big platform, honestly, but then that's why I would like to share it across the world. Yeah.
Now we head to the southern part of Africa, where homes and lives have been lost following a tropical storm called Storm Anna. The storm swept through Madagascar, Mozambique, and Malawi, leaving thousands of children without schools. Our reporter Nomsa is in Malawi with more details about the cyclone.
This is the heartbreaking sight of the aftermath of a deadly tropical storm, Storm Anna. What was once fertile land is now drowned in a large body of toxic water.
This area was affected by flooding back in 2015, but the people who live here have told me that the floods they've seen in recent days is something that they've never experienced in their lives. All that water moved from there and went on higher ground and swept away some of the houses, and have said that the winds were so strong that the houses here lost their roofs.
Storm Anna made landfall in Madagascar, destroying anything in the way. Then a few days later, Anna plowed through Mozambique and then traveled its way here to Malawi, carrying lashing rains and unbearable winds. This is what Anna left behind. Just like this one, tens of thousands of homes were damaged in the storm. Some roofs were blown away by ghastly winds. Others collapsed under heavy rain, even trapping victims in the rubble. More than 130,000 people fled their homes in Madagascar, taking nothing but their most valuable possessions. And now, schools and gyms in the capital, Antananarivo, have been turned into emergency shelters. Across the border in northern and central Mozambique, Anna has also destroyed 10,000 homes, dozens of schools and hospitals. Rescue workers and authorities across the southern African countries have been working tirelessly, day and night, since the storm hit this region. International aid organizations have also extended their help. UNICEF has begun creating temporary shelters in Mozambique for the children whose schools and classrooms were destroyed. The latest data shared by the National Institute for Disaster Management showed that over 27,000 pupils in the country were left without a classroom to study in. They've also deployed a team of experts to provide medical and nutritional material, water, sanitation, and hygiene kits for children and their families caught by the storm.
And it's not just Storm Anna which has caused devastation in southern Africa. Cyclone Batsirai, which is another type of storm, recently hit Madagascar, killing several people, and it also swept across Mauritius. So why are these cyclones getting stronger, and what has it got to do with climate change? Oceanographer Vasen Kopemutu explains.
With the impacts of climate change, the ocean temperatures are rising, and ocean temperature release, high ocean temperatures cause the release of a lot of energy in the atmosphere. And this energy fuels the formation of tropical cyclones and very intense tropical cyclones. Batsirai gave us a big thrill because we had some wind of up to 150 kilometers per hour. And we were supposed, I mean, if the cyclone would have come closer, it would have been 200 kilometers per hour. So a big threat for our islands. And we must not forget that with climate change, cyclones are becoming much stronger and bigger threat, and that as islanders, we have to adapt to those new phenomena which are coming to us.
Millions of children across Africa will continue to miss out on school and may not get quality education over the next decade. And that's according to the United Nations Education Agency, UNESCO. Simi found out why this is and spoke to some young people in Ivory Coast and Nigeria on why being in school is so important to them.
Everyone has a right to education, so says the United Nations. But its latest report has found that millions of children across Africa will continue to miss out on school over the next decade.
In 2015, African leaders agreed to a set of goals by the United Nations that aim to end poverty and inequality by 2030.
This included making sure children of all backgrounds and genders can complete pre-primary, primary, and secondary school, ensuring there are enough qualified teachers to teach them, and providing young people with reading, writing, and other skills to help them get good jobs. However, countries around the world, and especially Africa, are falling behind. Currently, 1 in 5 children who should be in primary school aren't. 3 in 5 girls don't complete lower secondary school. And by 2030, only around 2 in 3 children will be in preschool, while 8% of children who should be in primary school won't be.
So why would so many children be kept out of school? Well, one expert told us there are many reasons, like boys being made to work or girls made to start a family.
Poverty has been and remains a major challenge for many families and their children. Parents may not be able to afford to send their children to school, or they might want to keep them to work. Africa has suffered from its more than fair share of conflicts, displacement, challenges from natural disasters, linguistic and cultural diversity, sometimes be a problem because so many children are being taught in a language they don't speak at home.
Ismail, Miha and Fatima were all out of school because of family hardships. They told us why being in school is so important to them.
When I come to school, I can read, I can count, and I can write. If you don't send kids to school, you don't know what they can become.
My happiness cannot be described, and I'm here with my friends. If a girl is educated, she can become a doctor or teacher, but without being educated, you can't achieve these dreams.
I want to come to school to succeed. When I finish my studies, I want to become a maths professor.
There is some good news. The report also predicted that although right now 47% of all teenagers who should be in upper secondary school aren't,
that number will reduce to around 30% by 2030. A downward trend experts hope will continue as leaders make education a priority.
Heard of vermicompost? Well, it's simply organic compost made using earthworms to help in the decomposing process. So how do they do it? And what are the benefits? We head to Kenya to meet two sisters, Bethy and Ruth, who make vermicompost in their back garden to tell us more about it.
My name is Betty and I'm 17 years old.
Hi, I'm Ruth, I'm 12 years old.
Vermicomposting is the process of converting organic materials into organic fertilizer using earthworms.
I got interested in vermicomposting when I saw my dad working on his climate-based activity in a veranda.
My daughters, I did not quite teach them per se. They probably got it via osmosis, if I may. They saw what I was doing, and every so often they would come and give me a hand.
We get the ingredients from our kitchen, the organics,
e.g. the cabbages, ugali, potato peelings and sukuma wiki.
We get the cow dung from our neighbors, and the earthworms, we got them from a dealer in Nairobi. First, you will apply the cow dung on the bottom of the bin, mix with the organics and sprinkle some water. because the earthworms need moisture to live. Yes, at the beginning I got squeamish, but eventually I got used to handling the earthworms.
Eventually, even children get to know how to handle the earthworms because they are completely harmless. For us, it takes about 2 months to get the vermicompost.
The most challenging part of creating vermicompost, I would say it's harvesting, because it takes up the whole day to harvest just one bin.
Vermicompost is important to reduce the level of global warming.
It holds the gases in the soil and the plants look evergreen and healthy. People in our community, only a few of them know about the vermicast. Yes, I would like them to use it, but some of them think that it's weird. So not most of them like it.
Not all of them use it. It's a few who know about it. And I would like them to know more about vermicomposting.
Thanks, girls, and great job, by the way. Now, from worms digesting food waste, it's time to turn to us. Yes, humans and our relationship with food. Ever wondered what's behind the taste and spices used whenever we eat something? And why is eating junk food a really bad idea, even if it tastes so good? So many questions about what we eat. So it's your turn to ask nutritionist Ayumide Olukoshi about it.
How did ancient people know how to make food and to mix food and make it tasty?
I believe that it was primarily through trial and error. You know, as a child as well, sometimes you might mix food in the kitchen and you try to eat it and it doesn't taste good. That's how I believe a lot of our ancestors did it back in the day. They would maybe catch something and decide, oh, let me try it with this spice. And they would realize, oh, it lasted longer, but it didn't taste good. Or maybe it tasted good, but then it didn't stay very long. So then it was primarily trial and error until what they found what worked and then passed it on. And that's how we have our meals as we have them today.
Why is the healthy food more expensive than the other food?
Vegetables and fruits tend to be demonized and have a bad reputation and people don't want to eat them. In order to make the same economic benefit as a hamburger, they generally will price it higher because they know not as many people are going to come and buy the cucumber as they would the hamburger. Obviously, sometimes the problem is that you look at the cucumber, you look at the hamburger, and you're like, this is more expensive, so let me buy the hamburger. There's also the fact that the farmers also, it takes a lot of work to grow those fruits and vegetables. So then part of that money also goes towards the hard work that they put into it. I think primarily what we need to do is actually make fruits and vegetables more accessible and encourage more people to actually eat them. That way you can drop the cost.
Why does junk food taste better than healthy food?
So that's a very good question. I'm a dietitian and I do agree that sometimes junk food does taste better than healthy food. The problem is that a lot of the times, the junk food is actually filled with a lot of salt and sugar, which is very addictive. So it means that the minute we have a certain amount of sugar, we always want that kind of sugar. The difference is fruits and vegetables are very natural. So it's up to you to make of it what you want. So it's all about how we prepare our fruits and vegetables. If we prepare them well, you'll actually find that it tastes a lot better than what you the junk food that you buy, which a lot of the times is not fresh. It's heavily processed and contains a lot of nutrients like too much salt, too much sugar, too much oil that actually will hurt us in the long run compared to if you make it at home.
And now it's time to talk about snow, ice, and world-class athletes. Yes, that's right. I'm talking about the Winter Olympics. Now, whilst you might not associate Africa with winter sports, this hasn't stopped a group of Africa's finest athletes from heading to Beijing, China. One of these Olympians is skier Shannon Obnai Abeda, who competed as Eritrea's first ever Winter Olympian in 2018. Eritrea is a country with hot, scorching temperatures and not the usual winter mountain tops we associate with skiing. So how did Shannon end up taking to the slopes? We met up with him to find out.
My name is Shannon Obnai Abeda. I am an alpine skier from Eritrea. I'm Eritrea's first Winter Olympian, and I'm going to Beijing 2022. So I first started skiing when I was 3 years old in a small town in Fort McMurray.
At 15 years old, Shannon tried out for the qualifiers at the Youth Olympic Games.
When I first qualified, it felt amazing. I was really, really happy. And I just was in shock. Like, I've never been in an international competition.
He chose to represent the country of his heritage and where his parents were born in Eritrea, instead of where he was born in Canada.
I felt a bit isolated in my community here, and I felt different, and I wanted to still be that person that was different, and that's kind of why my decision of representing Eritrea. My first trip to Eritrea was amazing. Just seeing, you know, the cultural background, just seeing how much, like, where my parents grew up, how much it took for them to get to where they are. To be quite honest, it's been very difficult just for me being one of the only people of color in ski racing.
Shannon has overcome some challenges as a Winter Olympian.
My first significant injury was in 2016. I tore my ACL, MCL, medial meniscus, LCL, PCL, pretty much all the ligaments in my knee and left knee. So that was a year of rehabilitation just to come back. There was a period where I did slip into a depression. I struggled a lot to just find motivation to get myself in the morning and even get myself to the games. Like, it was a very difficult period. So after the games, I retired for about a year, just took a year to go back to school, kind of explore different parts of my life personally.
He decided to return to alpine skiing in time for the Beijing Olympics in 2022.
This year coming back hasn't been tough. It has been very tough for me, more or less emotionally and mentally, than it was the last Olympics. It's crazy for me to think, like, given everything that's happened, I'm here where I am right now. I was contacted by an Eritrean who just started cross-country skiing and wants to go carry the torch for me for 2026. So it's kind of stoked a little fire in me to push even harder.
And finally, how could we forget this? Of course we remembered. This was the atmosphere last Sunday in Dakar after Senegal won their first ever Africa Cup of Nations, beating Egypt on penalties in Cameroon. A final that sent young Senegalese fans over the moon, and we'll meet some of them next week. That's it from BBC What's New. See you next time. Bye.